This is the second video of Unit 1 about the cell membrane structures and function. Now let's move on. Animal cell membrane is consisting of different positions or different components, like as you can see in this picture. So this is the cell. Now if you cross section, we can make a cross section of the cell. You can look at structure like that. Then if we zoom into the structure here, we can find like this. Okay. Now the structure of cell membrane is simply, it's a fluid. It's like a jelly-like structure, right? It's a fluid. Onto this fluid, proteins are embedded. Some proteins are put onto the top of this sandwich, and some proteins are put inside of this sandwich. Some in the top, some on this just spanning whole region. It's called the transmembrane proteins, and there are also different varieties of proteins are present, and also carbohydrates are attached to either fats or these protein compounds. Okay. And if you zoom into the structure of the fat, you can find here it is made up with the phospholipids. Now as you know, the phospholipid is made up with two regions. One is the head group, which is where the phosphate is present, which is hydrophilic in nature, and on the other hand it is the lipid layer, which is the hydrophobic in nature. So these hydrophobic tail regions will come and interact with each other to produce this hydrophobic core, and hydrophilic head groups are facing towards the solution part, that means the extracellular space as well as the inner cytoplasmic space of a cell, and between this is the compact structure of it. Okay, so it's a bimembrane structure, not a monolayer, it's a bilayer structure, and proteins are embedded onto it. So proteins must have the hydrophobic residues on the surrounding regions to interact with these hydrophobic tail regions. So these are the simple concepts. And also there are carbohydrates. If the carbohydrates are attached with the proteins, they are called the glycoprotein. If they are attached to the lipids, they are called the glycolipids. Okay. So let's move on. And also there is another picture of this cytoskeleton parts. So these are made up with either actin filaments. So these filaments are made up with proteins. Now these protein filaments will hold the cytoplasm and the cell structure together. So like all the type of structures or backbones, you must have a framework through which onto the framework we will put all the ingredients to make a fully functional body or figure. So here the framework is provided by this type of cytoskeleton proteins. Okay. Now semi-permeable membranes, the lipid membranes are semi-permeable in nature. It's also called the selectively permeable membrane. That means this type of membranes do not allow the movement of all type of molecules. It allows a particular type of molecules to freely diffuse to this membrane and will block other types of molecules. Okay. Water moves across the membrane freely. Ions do not move across the membrane freely, especially the charged particles. Okay. And many large molecules do not move across the membrane. So how could these ions and this large molecule can move across the membrane? There are different proteins that are present. There are different channels that are present in between this cell membrane through which these ions and large proteins can pass through. Now, if you want to understand the property or the function of a membrane, you must know two different things. One is the diffusion, and another one is the osmosis. Now, what is diffusion? The diffusion means the movement of substances, whatever. It could be a solute, it could be a solvent, from an area of higher concentration towards the area of lower concentration. So it's always easier to grow from higher concentration to lower concentration to fulfill the gaps and make an equilibrium. So here in this picture, this is the higher concentration of the substrate, this is the lower concentration at the right end. Now the molecules from higher concentration will move to this lower concentration through this thin line, which is the membrane. We can imagine this is the membrane. And the second one is the osmosis. That means the movement of a solvent molecule, like water in this case, most of the time in biological system it's water, from an area of higher water concentration to the area of lower water concentration. So if we look at, imagine in this picture, so if water is the rest of the part and these red colored molecules are the solid parts, so it will move from this left to right to balance it. It's a normal diffusion. If we talk about the osmosis, to balance between this situation without traveling, without involving the travel of these red molecules, we need to flow this water from this right hand end towards the left hand end for balancing the situation, right? So osmosis means movement of solvent from high content to low content to balance the solute, okay, to balance the solute present in the solvent, right? Now what is the active transport? Active, so this is here in this case, this is the passive transport example. That means if we need to grow from the higher concentration towards the lower concentration, definitely no energy will be needed. It's a passive mode of transport. If you want to grow from the lower concentration of substance towards the higher concentration of substrate, it must need some amount of energy to put in because of completion of this work. Okay, so that's why it's called the active transport, where the energy or active energy is required. Now, membrane proteins play an important part of this passive as well as the active transport. There are some molecules that cannot freely diffuse to the membrane, but they are usually present in higher amount in the extracellular space, so they can easily enter into the inside the cell via the protein channels, or they are also called the carrier proteins. Now, here is the carrier protein structure. These are the transportable molecules. Now, this molecule will pass through this carrier protein. Now, sometimes small molecules can easily diffuse through, like water, it can easily diffuse through here. Water cannot diffuse through because it's a hydrophobic layer. Oxygen, carbon dioxide, and all these things can diffuse through easily from the extracellular space to the intracellular space. Water cannot, because it needs to go through this barrier of hydrophobic layer, but water cannot do this. So let me go back here. Normally water cannot move across, so this is not a good point to focus on. Okay, anyways, so if the molecule readily or freely passes through this cell membrane, we call it simple diffusion. Or if it needs any carrier protein for its passing from the extracellular space or from the high concentration towards the low concentration, we require a protein. This is still a passive transport, because no energy is required, but protein is required. So it's a facilitation of this process by this protein. So it's a it's called the facilitated diffusion. And on the other hand, in case of the active transport, that means from the lower concentration of the substrate it needs to go to the higher concentration, it must need the energy, and the energy is provided by the energy currency of the cell, which is the adenosine triphosphate or ATP. Now it will provide the energy, and also they need the carrier molecules or the protein molecules in this case. Now, very large molecules may be taken by endocytosis, like here the solid particles, as you can see, it's called the phagocytosis. Now, there are three different types of endocytosis are present: phagocytosis, pinocytosis, and receptor-mediated endocytosis. So, phagocytosis means engulfment of solid substances or particles, which are large particles like that. So, plasma membrane produces a sac-like structure like that. Invagination, in both the ends are produced. It will engulf the solid particle, and these two part of the membrane will come and fuse with each other to produce this circular sac or vacuole like complex. It's called the phagosome. Now this phagosome will go and fuse with other chemically loaded components, which are called the lysosomes, and it fuses with them. Now these lysosomes will supply all the enzymes, all the necessary enzymes for breaking down of the solid substances. Okay, so that's how the phagosome is produced, or you can also call them as endosome. Okay, and also pinocytosis, in case of pinocytosis, it's also a kind of endocytosis, but except for the solid particle engulfment, here is a liquid particle engulfment is actually done. The extracellular fluid is consisting of many liquid contents. Now this liquid contents will be engulfed by the cell membrane. So cell membrane actually not there's a difference between the engulfment process in phagocytosis and pinocytosis. In case of phagocytosis, this is a typical engulfment where in cellular membrane invagination will take place and will cover up the solid particle. But in case of pinocytosis, the cell membrane make a pinch inward of the cytoplasm to make a sac-like structure. Then the liquid molecules will come and enter into the sac structure. It will produce a vesicle. So the formation of these structures are varying. In case of phagocytosis, it is producing the engulfment structure of vacuole, but in case of pinocytosis, it's just creating a pinch inwards of the cytoplasm to produce the vesicle. Into the vesicle, they can carry the extracellular fluids. Okay. And the third type is the receptor mediated endocytosis, where the typical type of protein or a specific type of substances, not only proteins but different types of substances, can come and bind with the receptor. Only the specific type of protein which is able to bind with the receptor can be uptaken, all the other types of molecules will be discarded. So once when cell present in a vigorous mixture of molecules, it needs to decide when it needs molecule A, when it needs molecule B. So in this case, this is a mixture of orange and this blue colored molecules, but the cell in at this point need this orange color molecule, so it will bind to this orange color using this receptor, and then the cytosis happen, and then there are several different types of proteins called the clathrin proteins can come and produce a coat like structure in the inward position. It will help to bend the cell membrane in inwards of the cytoplasm, just like the phagocytosis process, and then it will engulf this substrate and produce this coated vesicle. Now after the production, again the same thing is happening. Lysosome will fuse with these vesicles and vacuoles, whatever. Then the enzymes will be released, solids will be degraded to the simple parts, and then they'll be discarded, they'll be released into the cytoplasm, and rest of this coat proteins are again recycled back to the cell membrane region for carrying out this cycle again and again and again. Okay, so that's it. And we've talked about endocytosis, that means the engulfment or taking up of particles inside the cell. Now let's talk about releasing the particles outside the cell, because it's also important. So cell, after utilizing all these substrates to produce energy and to produce all these things, it must produce any other types of toxic materials or other kind of byproducts. It needs to excrete out from the cell to live on. For this purpose, it needs to have again form these vesicles. The vesicle will contain the byproducts, or the vesicle will contain all the toxic materials. Then you can see here, this is the Golgi apparatus, and from this Golgi, so Golgi apparatus is a cellular sorting machinery, or the cellular substrate sorting machine. We sort all these proteins according to the needs, according to the release, and they will put them into the vesicle. After putting them into the vesicle, they'll produce this vesicle like structure, and they'll fuse this vesicle with the cell membrane, and it will release these toxic materials or byproducts outside of the cell. Okay, so here in this Golgi material, there are two different types of components, this green components and the blue components, and this blue and green components will produce a pinch, it produces this vesicle, and then the vesicle will go and fuse with the membrane, and the components can be released. So sometimes this component release can be depend upon a particular signal, which is called the regulated secretion. Sometimes it could be no regulation, so just a random process of removal of the cell debris and cell byproducts and toxic materials. So if it is depending upon the normal consecutive release of these materials, we call them the constitutive secretion. On the other hand, if it depends on the signaling, if it depends on the signal coming from the outside to the receptor, and then the whole process will be carried out. Like here, it is triggered by the calcium ion concentration. It is called the regulated secretion. Okay, so these are the two different types of secretion of exocytosis that can be present. So depending upon the situation the cell in, this type of secretion can happen. For example, in case of the neurotransmitter region, in case of the nerve ending or nerve junctions, calcium ion concentration is very important. So high concentration of calcium ion will lead to the signaling to the vesicle, which contains all the neurotransmitters like acetylcholine, glycine, and all these things. Now, as this signal reaches to the receptor, it signals the vesicle to fuse with the cell membrane and release all these materials outside. So it will be fused, and all these chemical components like acetylcholine, glycine, and all, they will be released to the outer membrane. They will be released to the neuromuscular junction, and they will function like this. Okay, so this is the exocytosis, and I hope this video will help you. Thank you.